You're listening to Lighthouse Conversations, brought to you by Lighthouse Haven, a spiritual home for your awakening soul. Lighthouse Conversations is a show where awakening souls gather to be inspired, connected, and enlightened. Spiritual spark plug and host, Chelly Canales, that's me, will guide you through the twists and turns of your journey to a safe haven where you are finally free to live your best light. Each episode contains a conversation with a guest who has gone through a spiritual awakening, detailing their unique and life-changing experiences in an intimate and candid way. Although everyone's experience is as unique as they are, we all share one common thread. We're all seeking something. So, come join us on this journey and be prepared to leave with resources that will supercharge you into inspired action. Here's today's episode. Hello, awakening souls. How's your sheltering at home going? I hope you're finding some time to take good care of yourself, to spend time with your loved ones, whether that be over the phone, online, all those amazing tools we have in technology that help keep us connected even when we can't see each other face to face. And I was thinking back to, you know, years past when our society has experienced pandemics and how lucky we are to be in a time where we actually have technology that can have us see each other face to face. I mean, what a gift. Of course, there's always things that, you know, are tricky about that. You know, people wanting to take advantage of Zoom meetings and Zoom bombing and things of that nature. And, you know, no matter what happens, you find the people who are willing to show up and make a further mess out of a tragedy. But then you find the people who are showing up with so much heart and so much love during times that are truly challenging. We find ourselves acting in ways that we don't necessarily think we would have acted before, but there's grace, I think, to be given to the confusion and to, you know, the actions we take that may not be in complete alignment with ourselves. You know, we can't be perfect at our diets. We can't be perfect at our exercise. We can't be perfect at our work, at any of these things right now. And that is okay. Please understand that everything you're doing is fine. It's more than fine. You're going to be fine, and we're going to get through this. So some of us are sheltering at home by ourselves. Some have roommates that are dear friends. Some have spouses and children. And I think it's interesting because during this time when spouses are spending more time together, certain things that, you know, are maybe lingering under the surface in terms of challenges or things to be talked about are suddenly becoming very urgent and present, because when you spend that much time together, it's bound to happen. And this can really be a unique opportunity to, you know, work through those things in a really loving and conscious way, because the stress, you know, the stress can just be so high. So this interview today with Linda Carroll, she's the author of Love Skills. We recorded this before the pandemic struck and people were stuck at home together. But I think there's so much value in what she's saying, and in her book right now, which is a manual that which talks about the various cycles of love, which was another book she wrote called Love Cycles. And I think people, when they're not equipped with the knowledge, they maybe don't understand that, you know, certain things, certain feelings are completely normal, and that there's really conscious ways to work through those things. You know, it doesn't mean you should end your relationship if you've lost that feeling of, like, you know, goo goo, I am so in love with you. You know, I can't imagine my life without you. I want to spend every moment with you. You know, that's just one part of the many cycles of love that lead to a wholehearted love. And guess what? Sometimes it starts all over again. So if we know that, if we're aware of that, it's so much easier to go through them, you know? And this book has some really great questionnaires, some to do personally, you know, one-on-one, and some to do as a couple. And I was just really fascinated by her take on love. And she's a therapist, and, you know, I'm sure currently right now she's seeing many people online, but I found just a lot of value, a lot of wisdom in what she has to offer. So please take a moment, whether you're partnered or single. There's just so much to be taken here, and digested. And I think I joked around, I'm like, this is really going to help people. Like, I wish everybody should get this manual before they start a relationship ever. And granted, you know, there's certain things in life we have to learn on our own. We have to go through them by ourselves, and that's okay. But here you go, Linda Carroll. Enjoy.
And welcome to the show, Linda Carroll. I'm so thrilled to have you here.
I'm so excited to be here.
What a beautiful book you have in Love Skills. This is your second book, beginning with Love Cycles. This is, to me, it seems like the companion piece where you, first of all, you understand what those cycles are in love. And then this is the manual, the handbook to get you going through those cycles and having a really wholehearted, full relationship. To me, I think everybody who's in a relationship ever should just get one. Like, here you go. You're welcome.
Sort of what I thought when I was writing the book. I was writing it for myself and thinking, what if I'd had this book at 12? But of course, I wouldn't have read it at 12. But what this would be the book that I wish I had had during my life. I wish I'd known this stuff. And I guess the other thing is that we don't know it till we're ready to know it. You know, it's not, there's so much about this world that we don't get to really learn it until we're open to learning it. So I wouldn't have read it at 12. I would just read love poems and think that was what it was.
Well, that's one part of it, though, when you learn to activate the part of yourself that connects with love poems. And that's so potent as well. And it's such a part of the journey. It's a part of the cycle, I think. It's amazing. I just look back at the various relationships I've had, and I'm not currently in one, but I know the next one I'm in, I'm going to use this, but I can identify all of those cycles, no matter how short or long the relationship it is. So you really have so much knowledge here that is, it just hits the nail on the head. Mm-hmm. I want to hear about how this book came to be, not only the books, but your life journey. You started out, you were a flower child in San Francisco, and you worked your way to becoming this incredible, space holder and activator for people to have the greatest relationships of their lives through this understanding. Can you talk me through that?
Well, I had the most amazing experience 2 weeks ago. So can I talk about that?
Yes, please.
I met a girlfriend from high school, and I hadn't seen her in 60 years or 58 years or something. And we met on the street where this boy lived that I fell madly in love with when I was 11. I start the book talking about what happened when I met him at 11 years old. I was this little Catholic school girl with no clue about the chemical surge of love. And I met this boy and I lost my mind for a long time, not knowing it was chemicals. And I have taken that apart over and over again, that relationship. And that has been kind of the impetus for this journey, because what I didn't understand was that the feelings were not about having that the strength of the feelings that I felt, and I had nothing to prepare me for this, that the strength didn't mean this is someone I was supposed to be with. It meant something, it meant a lot of other things, but not that. And when I was with my girlfriend, we were talking about love skills, and we were talking about him, and we were talking about his best friend who she went out with. And then I went to get a massage, and I had booked it in just a place that was open 2 blocks away. When I walked up to where the massage was, I looked around, I thought, this is his house. I hadn't been there for 60 years.
What?
I was in this on Union Street in San Francisco. I looked up and the house was long gone, but there was a massage place called Oxygen. And I was there in his room getting a massage in the exact place where all the trouble started in my life. So that was pretty, talk about the circle. And I was full of love skills had just come out. This is 2 weeks ago. And I was just, and it's like all of it came back to me again, and it was just almost like a movie that I couldn't believe it. And I told the massage therapist, who was so great, she said, I can't believe this. And she was a very skilled, because I said, I am in my old boyfriend's room. I mean, what happened is I got whacked with, you know, if you can remember that Aphrodite was the goddess of love.
Yes.
Cupid. And I got the thunderbolt. And I didn't expect it. I didn't know, you know, I was going to be a nun, or, you know, I was a little idealistic girl, and I was just knocked over. And it was a really inappropriate, he had a secret name for me. And I found out that later he had a secret name for my best friend, who's still my best friend. And we still talk about it. But what happened, it was a very inappropriate person, and I had a pretty traumatic growing up experience. And I had a lot of difficulty with early experiences with my family. I didn't have good grounding. So when I felt those feelings, I thought that was love. And even though that relationship hit the dust, there was another dysfunctional relationship waiting in the wings, and another one after that. And my history of love became a disastrous history. And I didn't understand what it was. I thought the feeling, when you feel a certain amount of, you know, sort of crazy attraction to someone, that means that's somebody you're supposed to be with. And it took me, and then when I finally sort of came out of that trance, which was many years, decades, like till I was about 34, I thought, I keep getting into these inappropriate relationships. I don't want to do that anymore. And I got into a lot of therapy to try to understand why, if you put a blindfold on me and you put me in Yankee Stadium, and you know, like people right now, I put a mask over my face, everything, I would find my way to the most dysfunctional person that I could save in the whole Yankee Stadium.
Right.
I thought, why? I don't want to save anybody. I was trying to save my father. That was that's the short version of a very long psychotherapy process. And if I found someone who was needy and depressed and I could save them, I could help that little girl. So I got that piece worked out. And when I did, my whole experience with love changed, and I began to understand that love is something based on a lot of skills. It's the feeling is one thing, and for some people, they feel the feeling and they meet somebody and that's it. They go off into the sunset. But for most of us, that feeling is only the feeling of attraction. It doesn't mean that person is compatible. It doesn't mean that that's a person who can go the distance, who has the qualities to do it. And even if they do, we need skills to get to wholehearted. Feelings are great, but they don't carry us through, because love is seasonal. Relationships are seasonal. And you know, each human, we bring a lot of trouble into life. It comes and gets us into life. We don't mean for whatever. It's just the human journey. You put two people together and you need to have skill to navigate those journeys. And without those skills, love just dies a very sad death. So love cycles. And so I did marry someone when I was 40 who was an appropriate person, and we did not have an easy time. We had a lot of love, but we didn't have skills. We were both control freaks. We still are, but we manage it. But we were committed, and he has been my best friend since I met him at 30. So we were committed, but we didn't know what to do to get out of the power struggles. And so we started to study with everyone we could. These won't mean much to people who are listening, but he is a veterinarian, but he became as my partner. We became imago therapists, and we became facilitators in something called PAIRS. We learned skills, and the skills we learned are what actually gave us the love we wanted, not the feeling. It was the skills. When you have two people who have very different feelings about life and who do things differently, you need more than a feeling. And one of the things I do in the Love Skills book is I talk about the fight we've had. We actually had it last night, and it started when we were 30. The first time we met, and it sounds funny, but it's not, which is about how to do dishes. And oddly enough, that is a huge issue with couples. It wasn't just us, but I go through all the five stages, and I use that example of what, like when we first started, he made fun of me, I made fun of him, but it was like cute, sort of fun. Like, you don't need to use all that hot water. Like, well, you don't need to, you know, blah, blah. And we thought the other was cute. And then we moved in together and it became sort of serious. It became a power struggle. And then it became in the third stage, which is real disenchantment. We had an absolute sort of a blowout in front of people we were having to dinner that we didn't even know about how to do the dishes. And it wasn't cute or funny. In fact, brought these people that looked stricken into this argument, telling them each our side, asking them which way is right. And
yeah. Pick a side, guys.
That was a nice way to introduce people to our compatible life. And I'm a marriage counselor in the town, and these were people we didn't know. It was mortifying. And there we were doing this like 3-year-olds. But then afterwards, we realized we've got, this isn't working. We can't do this. Like, this is about the dishes. You know, there's got to be a way to manage our differences without doing harm. And we started practicing the skills. And we still get into it about the dishes now. So, but you know what? It's not a big deal. We laugh at ourselves. And so it's using, so I took that trouble. And we've all got little troubles. And then there are the big troubles that come in that are inevitable. So if we don't have skills to manage differences and how we do things and how we feel at different times, what our needs are at different times. You know, some people need to be close and sometimes we need distance, and relationships have both, and people are not in the same place. Sometimes one person needs distance when the other needs close. How do we navigate that without harming love, without hurting each other?
And you have so many amazing exercises in here to sit down to either do by yourself or to do with your person and work through very specifically for tangible results, the activities that you have here. And I find that is so helpful. Not only are people not aware that there are cycles, they think everything is over when you hit like stage three, or, you know, like this is it. But if you can, first of all, be prepared to know that there are cycles, and I'm going to ask you, if you don't mind, to explain what those cycles are in a moment, but to also have, here is a guide to walk you through what happens when you get to this space. I think it's essential for relationships to have this information. And I'm also curious how you discovered that those were the cycles. Was it through your personal experience or a combination with, you know, all the people that you work with on a personal coaching level?
Well, okay, I'll answer the second question first, and that is that I this work stands on the shoulders of so many people that I studied with and learned from, and I think that it, what's interesting, I mean, it follows the cycles of seasons. You can talk about seasonally, summer, winter, spring, foggy days, boring days, hot days, but I also, there's a lot of research and a lot that's written about how our and I can talk about the cycles from this, how are the cycles of love mirror what happens when we're born, that we're born in the merge. And that's the first stage of love, where we melt into the other person and we think we found our other half. And if you look at the infant and the mom, who's usually the primary caretaker, at least in the first part, that you, the baby doesn't know the difference between itself and its caretaker. They are one another. They just gaze all the time. And I remember him and I were in that first stage, the merge. We used to talk about looks. I mean, we would be anywhere and we would just be staring at each other. And it was like, we would just give each other these looks like, where have you been? Oh my God, all my life. And it was the merge. And that was the same experience that infants have. And then at some point, we start to realize that we are not half of another person. We haven't found our other half. In fact, our journey is to become our whole within ourselves, not to be another person's half. And at that point, that, and if you look at that developmentally, what happens is that's when the baby turns into a toddler who says no. Call that the terrible twos, don't we? The power struggle, where you're not me. You're not the boss of me. I want to wear this different thing. And I can just, I have a picture of what my youngest son, oh, so cute, on his first, going off to nursery school or something. He was 2 and a half, for going off for a half day. And he would not wear socks that matched. He was, and I just let him do it. And he had this mismatched outfit, but he was so proud. And I have a picture of him still with that I love. And it's like, it's that need to say, wait a minute, I'm me. And that's very painful. So we've been in this merge with this idea that you're me and I'm you and you're my soulmate. And where have we been? And then we start to realize we're not each other and we're not even the same in a lot of ways. In fact, the things we fall in love with start to be the things we want to change that annoy us. And then we start to move into the power struggle. Mm-hmm. And as we move into the power struggle, that's where the skills, another set of skills, we need a different, in the first set, we need different skills, but how do we navigate this? And that's not, doesn't mean that the relationship is bad. You know, I write a lot of blogs. I write a lot for Mind Body Green and Little Buddha, Tiny Buddha. And I read a lot about, when I have a topic, I'll read everything I can on it. And one of the things I have read a lot is articles that say, how do you know when it's time to leave a relationship? And many of these articles list the things that are normal in love.
Oh, yes. That's so misleading.
so misleading. You know, that's right, because it's you're really connected, and then there is this piece like the 2-year-old that says, I want to get away from you. I want to go play in my room and shut the door. I want to sleep in a different bed tonight. And we have some idea that that means something's wrong. It doesn't, mm-hmm. Where have I been? I miss me. I want to go feel myself. And we're also in that power struggle stage too. I call that disillusionment or denial, because we're really, that power struggle is really making us doubt that we're even with the right person. But worse than that, we've lost ourselves. And sometimes those power struggles turn into what I call infinity loops. And I describe those. Mm. And loops are where we have the same argument over and over. We go through the same, all paths lead to this same trouble. And often it may work that one person starts to withdraw and the other person feels abandoned and goes after them. And the person who withdraws more. And then the other person becomes more critical, and we just loop it round. And sometimes people get locked in that loop, and they get locked for a long time, and they think the relationship is the loop. And I call that disillusionment, which is the opposite of enchantment, is disenchantment, right? And that's where we can do hard moves. That's where trouble, real trouble happens. Shutoffs and cutoffs and shutdowns and affairs and all that starts to happen. And then we think, what am I doing with this person? And then what happens is people can't stand that, mostly, hopefully, for too long. Although some people stay in that lockdown place for a long time, years.
It takes so much energy. It's just, why? Why are you putting yourself through that? Either figure it out or go. So this is your opportunity to figure it out, because it can be done.
Yes, it can. And, you know, it does take so much energy. And I think it creates so much stress. It can make us sick. And so then what happens is that we make a decision. I'm going to leave. I'm going to get help and figure out I'm going to do the work. Or I'm going to just go into parallel lives. Some people decide at that point, we're not going to leave the relationship, but we're going to give up hope that it can be more. Here's one, I'm going to do a sidebar. The really great news is for me, I'm a coach, and I do a lot of work online now, but I also see people. People come more sooner and sooner. I see more people who are still in the merge, who say, we know that this can't be this way forever. And so therefore we want to do something to make it
last
and to avoid the pitfalls. So when I started 38 years ago in marriage counseling, people came and they were in their last breath. But that's not true anymore. A lot of people come saying, we want the skills before we get into a mess. And that's really great.
But do they recognize that the merge doesn't last forever, that you do have to go through the cycles to eventually come back to that space where you can have that, you know, those feelings again, but not with, you know, without working for them? Does that explain it right? Tell me if I'm off.
I think that they recognize it intellectually. When you're in the merge and you feel all those feelings, mm-hmm. you really secretly think you've broken the code. And that the feelings will be there. But people, maybe they've been through a few love rodeos.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, we don't want that to happen. Or they've seen a little bit of it, but it hasn't gotten really bad. And they have, you know, and there's so much great information out. I mean, there's great, lots of other books besides mine that are out that are really good about what we understand about stages of love. And I think that's probably part of it, is how much availability there is. For understanding that having a fight or being different or feeling sometimes like you can't stand your partner is not really the reason to leave a relationship, because it can come back. And so that's the fourth stage, is the decision. And then the fifth stage is wholehearted love, because doing the skill, practicing those skills, get you back to yourself where you know you're whole. But here's the deal. You don't stay in any of those stages. It's like consciousness. You don't say, oh, I'm in wholehearted love, and now we're here and we'll just be here
forever and ever.
Forever and ever. But you know how to get back there. You know how to get into trouble with each other, or you get into boring days or angry days or sad days or days where you don't want to just, you're not angry, but you just want your own space. But you know how to find your way back to each other and back to wholehearted. So it's like you live there, but you don't stay there all the time. Does that make sense?
Yes, of course it does. And it makes sense just like with any journey, whether it's, you know, your spiritual awakenings, whether it's growing and learning, you're always going to go through these cycles. It's never going to be like, hooray, I've made it forever. We got this. And it's never going to be challenging anymore because we don't grow if that's the case. That your relationship, I believe, can reach new heights when you go through these things. You have a deeper understanding, a greater understanding. Yeah. I wanted to ask you, because you say that love is an inside job, and I want to hear more about what that means from your perspective. From being, I've been single for a while, been out of a relationship for a while, and all I keep hearing is, well, when you truly love yourself, then the right person will come. And I'm like, I love myself. I don't know what that means exactly to tell me, you know, if you don't love yourself, you're not gonna be able to attract it. So it almost makes it seem like it's my fault in a way. I want to talk about what love is an inside job means. And is it truly something where it's without a doubt, if you have the proper amount, the exact percentage of love in your heart for yourself, then the right person will come.
I just think that that's absolute BS. Yeah. I just think that one of those cliches that is just so untrue. First of all, love is a feeling. What does it mean to love yourself? You know, Some days I think I just remember a couple weeks ago, I was feeling really good about my book. It was so exciting. And I did an interview on TV and I looked at it and I just couldn't stand how I looked and what I said. And I went through that and I thought, oh God, why did I answer that way? Why did I sit that way? And I think we go through those feelings all in a day. It's a feeling. It comes. And I love this expression. One day a peacock feather, the next day a feather duster.
Oh yeah, that's a good one. I can relate to that.
Self-love, what is self-love? I mean, I think there's self-care and I try to practice that, but sometimes the best self-love is when we do the things. I have a nonprofit and I work with migrants in Mexico, and that's probably when I am the closest to self-love is when I'm in that shelter and I'm seeing these incredibly courageous people that are funny and have lost everything, but they're generous. And I feel so grateful that I can do something for them because I know that it's a, you know, line in the sand that makes the difference between why they're there and I'm here. Sometimes when I do something for my neighbor who's really an invalid, I feel better about myself. I'm glad I do it. But I don't, when I'm buying clothes, I shouldn't. That's self-indulgence. It's not self-love. Or when I'm admiring myself, that's going to fall into another category. I think self-love is a myth. I think that the more we have respect for ourselves, the more we do the things we don't want to do, like go to the gym, go for a walk, you know, have a salad for lunch instead of a donut. I think that that's self-care, but self-love is a myth. Sometimes my self-love comes best because whatever that word means. Sometimes my self-respect comes because I've made a decision in my relationship to care for my partner in a way that doesn't feel like I want to do it. I just do it because I feel like it's right. And then I'm glad I did it. But that's, you know, the idea of self-love is you walk around and you're this whole person and you've arrived at some amazing place and you'll never fall into being a feather duster again. I just think it's absolute BS. I don't believe it exists. Just like perfect love and unconditional love doesn't exist for humans. I think I have it for my dog.
I've heard that before. There's something special about a relationship with an animal, especially a dog. I get that.
Closest, but I sure don't have unconditional love for my husband at all. You know, sometimes I love him crazily and other times I'm just annoyed and I don't feel anything except just let me alone and let me just make the dinner by myself and don't tell me how to do it. And it doesn't mean there's anything wrong. It means we're human. So I think that there's another word though that I really like, and it's called self-partnering. And ooh, that means something to me because ultimately I think we are partnered with ourselves. This is the person that we have to live with from the beginning to the end of our life story. And this is the person I better have a good relationship with. And sometimes when you're not with somebody else, that's the time where you really get to know yourself. I remember being at a conference once and the woman said, when you're with yourself, you're with the most important person there is. And I didn't know what she meant. I thought about it for 2 weeks. I thought, how can you, and I was thinking by myself. And then I got it, with yourself. And I thought, what does it mean to be with myself? Because I always felt I was by myself. And who could I be with? Could I call a friend? Would I have a boyfriend? But then I suddenly, there was this difference between what does it mean with myself? And I remember I walked around a museum by myself and I started to look at the art, and I love museums. I love museums. And I could just get lost in them, all of them, the different exhibits. And I started to have this conversation with myself in my head, wondering about the painting I was seeing and thinking about the colors. And then I got it. I am with myself right now, not by myself. I'm enjoying my own company. And from that, I started to work on the idea of being with myself. But that's different than self-love. That's self-partnering. Does that make sense?
Completely makes sense. And I've had those moments in my life as well where it's like, it's a real joy. And I truly do value my own time, my own personal time. And I think in partnerships, it's easy for people to get a little bit annoyed or upset if partners want to be apart. And it's just like, it's remembering that time with you and reconnecting with yourself. And that's essential. So then what is love as an inside job compared to that self-love stuff we were talking about?
I think love is an inside job, meaning I've got to know how, I've got the skills. One of the things about the book that's really important is that I say in the very beginning, if you don't have a partner, this book is great for you anyway. But if you do have a partner, that don't set something up by saying we have to do this together. Often in a relationship, one person carries the flag for communication skills and personal growth. And the other person, who may do all kinds of great things in the relationship, doesn't really want to talk about issues, would rather go for a bike ride. And so the inside job is I can do the work. You know, sometimes I've run into certain issues in my own relationship, which has been going on as a marriage for almost 35 years, when my husband wouldn't negotiate. He wouldn't even look at it. And I thought, I would come to a point where I would say, I'm not going to leave him. I'm not going to change him. How can I do this differently inside of me? And I would do it differently. And sometimes that he would then shift. And but I was no longer in the drama. You know, I was no longer in the story. And I think we've got to work with ourselves, and we can make a lot of changes to make our life and our path forward mean we can walk it in a lot more integrity, regardless of what our partner is doing.
Yes, and forcing partners or family members or anyone that you have a relationship with to change, or putting expectations on them saying, I can only be happy if you follow A, B, C, D, and E, is just not the way to have a relationship. And I think people get stuck in, well, I should have things the way I want them. I'm the creator of my own reality. And why would I be with someone who doesn't reflect those things back for me? That never works.
And people get into it about food and a lot. You know, one person wants to go vegan and the other person wants to just hunt things and have all of their animals in the freezer, and they love each other and they've been together 14 years and they've got a great life. But one person suddenly wakes up and says, I'm going to go completely vegan. And so how do they work it out? And you know what they start usually is by trying to convince each other, and that never works. So when I say love is an inside job, if I decide to go vegan and use your big extremes, my husband is a hunter, which he isn't actually, he's a veterinarian. It's sort of the opposite. But I try to convert him to being a vegan. And then we get into lots of trouble about that. But when I say love is an inside job, it means I've got to honor that that's his right. And how can I take care of how I need to eat? How can he take care of how he needs to eat without trying to reform the other person? And part of that inside job is doing what I need for my own food. But part of it is finding a way to honor him and not putting articles on his desk all the time about how meat will kill him before he's 40. So that's what I mean by love is an inside job. We've got to do the work in here, not on the other person, because for one thing, it doesn't work.
It doesn't. And it's empowering to say, I have some responsibility here for how this can turn out. I'm not going to fully put it on somebody else. So are there times when people go through the cycles who do the work and still say, okay, this is not going to work? And is there a right time for that?
Yeah, of course. But, you know, people ask me a question that they ask me this, and I get this question probably more than any other question. Are you ever with a couple and you know that they're not going to make it? That's the question. And my answer is, and I'm going to answer what you just said in the same way, I never know I have sat with people in the biggest mess you can imagine. I mean, unbelievable messes. And they've worked it out. They've worked it through and they've said, we're going to stay together and we're going to work this out. And they do. And I've sat with people who seem to have everything going for them and have little tiny differences, but there's something not there. And they split. So I don't have any formula except that if you're in danger, you need to leave. But other than that, I've seen people work out impossible things. And so to me, they seemed impossible. And they worked, they got a really good relationship from the work they did because they were willing to stretch. So I don't answer that question except you have to stay safe. And that's my line. The rest is, you know, I don't know what anybody else's journey is. I just barely know my own. And some days I don't know that. So I hope that it's not, I'm not evading the question, but I honestly don't know. I just honor, I say to my clients, I'm the plumber. Just tell me what you want to work on and I'll give you the skills. And what you do with that is yours. It's not mine.
That's a very fair answer. I guess I wasn't expecting a clear yes. 54% of people should definitely walk out after doing the skills if such and such doesn't happen. But, no, that makes a lot of sense. You're just there as the plumber. I love that.
That's right.
One other thing before we dive into how people can get a hold of your book and your work. A big thing for me in relationships or deciding whether or not to see a partner or not is energy. I can feel a vibe on someone. I can see it's that intangible something. Do you find that plays, how does that play into this work as well? These are the things we're working on, but then there's that thing on the outside too, that's ever present. And to me, like also a make or break.
Well, I think that has really, that's a great question. I think in the couples who make it, even though they may have a mess that most of us would run from, that are determined to clean it up, there is that energy, there is that something between them that's intangible. And it's not soulmate stuff. I don't believe in any of that, but that there's something in their gut or heart that says, I want to work this out with you. And for the other people that walk away, sometimes that isn't there. And that is something, I don't know what that is. I don't think it's the chemical high of being in love, because I know that I have felt so furious at my partner at times, but I never lose that sense, and I haven't for 40 years, of I find him the most interesting person I've ever met. But I sometimes just want to get away from him, and I just want to hurt him, and I want to ignore him, and I want to just go off for a week and not listen to hear his voice. But I always want to come back and say, how are you? And when I do see him, I mean, I work in Mexico 10 weeks a year now. And so when we're separated, I'm so excited to see him again, even if it goes bad in 2 minutes, which it sometimes does. You know, I'll walk in and the house will be, I'll be so excited to see him, and I'll walk in, the house is a mess, the dishes are in the sink, and suddenly I'm furious. But then the entry that comes back, there you are, I see you. And I think that's an intangible. I don't know what that is.
It's just something you really, I guess you can't put to words. It's a feeling, and or it's a, you know, not a chemical feeling, but it's something else. And it's also the agreement when you're both in line to want the same commitment from each other. I think you're both like, yes, no matter the dishes, I'm with you. I'm going to work with this for you. Dishes sure are a catalyst. They truly are. They're a metaphor for so many things. It's amazing.
Boy, that's another one.
So, well, I want to talk more like about how people can get in touch with your work, because I'm finding it extremely valuable. And I truly want everybody to get this book because it's going to make waves. All of the divorce rates are going to go down after the publication of this book. I'm calling it right now. I want to know, you know, from the work that, oh yeah.
I do in the book talk about people splitting and saying you can also move apart wholeheartedly. You can do that. So I'm sorry.
That's an excellent point, because I think sometimes we go through these things to have our personal growth and realize that that's not the right partner we're supposed to stay with, but it was the right partner at the time for what we needed to learn.
Yes.
So you've been doing this work a very long time. You said 38 years. What made you decide to go into publishing these books?
I think I work a lot at a place called Rancho La Puerta, and it's a destination health spa in Tecate, Mexico. And I would talk about relationships, and in love cycles, I started doing graphics because I'm really visual. And I sort of put the stages up as, well, it's kind of like this. First, there's the merge. And then a woman who was a publisher came up to me. She said, you have a book there. And I said, oh, no, I'm not going to do this book. She said, no, you do. You have to do it. And as I started to think about it, and I'm there by myself at Rancho La Puerta for a week or two at a time, and I began to just write. And pretty soon I did have a book. And so that it came very organically. It didn't come from me thinking I'm going to write a book. It came because I kind of wrote it. And I mean, then there was a lot of work afterwards, but I was started by just making charts for people describing what I had learned in my time as a therapist.
The work had been created already. It was just a matter of organizing it.
That's right.
Well, I'm so thrilled for you to introduce this book into the world. Tell me how people can know more about it and about you.
They can go to any online, any bookstore or any online Amazon, whatever, wherever they want to go. It's called Love Skills. And my website is lindacarroll.com, LindaCarroll.com. And my Instagram is called Linda Carroll Official, which is really a funny name. My Instagram person created it from my other Instagram. And so I post on that. I post all kinds of fun things on that, including pictures of my dog sometimes.
After reading about this dog, I've got to know what your dog looks like. So I will follow you.
It's great. The last picture was him in a boat going down a river. And I was just reminding people summer's not too far. And there was Jackson with his life jacket on in a boat out in the river with my husband. He's so cute. But I post also quotes and stuff. So lindacarroll.com, and you can get the book anywhere that books are sold.
Well, congratulations to you on getting your wonderful work out into the world. It truly is meaningful. You're changing people's lives. Thank you for being you and doing all that you do.
Well, thank you. It's been wonderful to talk to you.
My pleasure.
Thank you for listening to Lighthouse Conversations. If this show resonates with you, it would mean so much to have you rate, review, and share. Don't forget to follow us at chellycanales.com and on social media.